I will bless thy name forever and ever. Read. Every day will I bless thee, and I will praise thy name forever and ever. Come on. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. Come on. One generation shall praise thy works to another and shall declare thy mighty acts. Verse 4, one more time. One generation shall praise thy works to another and declare. And declare thy mighty acts. I really want to magnify on the first part of verse 4, which says, one generation shall praise thy works to another. One generation praises the name of the Lord and shares their faith with the next generation. I want to minister, amen, from the subject matter this morning, winning a generation. Winning a generation. And for my subtopic, I want to talk about millennial complexity. We're going to talk to our millennials today, and I'm going to break that down, open that up, and I'm going to take a look at some of the unique challenges that they have, amen, in their generation, and to help some of us who are not a part of that generation, help us to understand them. Help us to speak their language, because many times we don't understand, amen, one generation. You know how it was when our grandparents and our parents looked at us for wearing Jerry curls and the other little fads and trends that came through, and they thought we was crazy. And if you go back a generation before that, their hair was fried, dyed, and laid to the side. Some of y'all remember, what was it? Man, what did it say? Diamond in the back. Now, if you notice, they didn't even get in on that chant. If you notice that they didn't understand what we're talking about. But if I say your price is too high, you need to what? Some of y'all looking like, because they got a song out in their culture say, your price is too high. You need to cut it. You need to cut it. And they got a couple other songs that I can't even talk about. But for some of us, diamond in the back. Do some of y'all remember white walls? Now, some of the people in this generation don't know what white walls are, but they do know what spinners are. Yeah. Sister Williams, you got some spinners? Sister Williams said, yeah, I know what spinners are. I got my spinners and my white walls. You fly in every generation. Okay, I got you. Holy Spirit, speak to us. Let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Bless the word is my prayer in Jesus' name. And all God's people said amen. Amen. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. I got on my tennis shoes this morning because I'm trying to speak to another generation. Statistics show that if you just put on some tennis shoes, they'll listen to you much more than they would if you had on some other shoes. Just a subtle change to help speak the language. Today, I want to talk about winning a generation, because it is obvious, amen, in Christendom, not only in America, but throughout the world, that we are losing a generation. There's a generation of people that are not being impacted. They are not being affected by the word of God, by the work of the Lord. They are insensitive to the things of God. They marginalize our faith. They do not think it is important to come to church. They do not think it is important to hear the word of God. The moral principles and standards that are being taught and preached from pulpits all over America and the world, many of millennials do not see it as important. As a matter of fact, there's about 60% of millennials that check out. Soon as they get 18, they're done with church. You will never see them again. That statistic goes higher when you look at young men that recently the age of 18, 21, when they get out of their mama's house, even if it's 43 years old, help me somebody, they stop coming to church. They don't want to serve God. We have a small retention, amen, of that, amen, millennial generation. Let me begin to stay focused with my lesson and do just a little bit of reading. A millennial is a period of 1,000 years. But millennials also refer to those reaching, those people reaching young adulthood around the year 2000. Millennials are also known as Generation Y. They are the demographic following Generation X. They're born, some of them reach their maturity because they were born in the 80s all the way up through the early 2000s. The children of baby boomers. They now outnumber every generation that has been in America. Right now, millennials are between 75 million and 80 million strong, which are stronger than baby boomers. The numbers stronger, demographic numbers stronger than Generation X. Even your grandparents, there are more millennials alive than any other generation in the history of America. There are more people alive between the age of 13 and 35 than they are 36 to 50 or 60 or 51 to 75, and certainly older than that. And then when you go back younger, 12 years to zero, there are more of this demographic alive than any other demographic. Yet when you look in our churches, it's the biggest demographic in the world, but the smallest demographic in our church. And if that demographic, if this demographic of millennials is growing and outnumbering all of the other generations and demographics in the world today, then who do you think is going to come in power? Whose ideals and systems do you think are going to influence and dominate the world? If your grandmother, amen, had a cause for Christ and a commitment to the word of God and going to church, hey, as my grandmother did, your mother did, Vanetta, as Mother Janice Thomas was born, raised in the church, trained her family up to go to church, was a Sunday school teacher in the church, birthed a whole generation in my aunt, my mom, amen, of people that served God, and their faith was passed down to me, my generation, my brother, Donnell, our brother. We were raised up in church. We were whooped in church. We learned the word of God. We went to Sunday school. We were in the Christian play. We sang in the choir. We were junior deacons. We were ushers. In other words, our faith, our religious background was part of our inheritance and our heritage. But we're seeing a generation of young people come up between the age of 13 and 36 where some kind of way the previous generation did not make it important for them to learn the word of God. If you ask them to quote certain scriptures, can you quote any verses? Not to put them on the spot, but it's very few of them that can quote passages of scripture where, Kathleen, we learned how to quote the Bible when we were children. We had speeches that were like a page and a half long that were filled with the word of God and full of the story of God. And then even our religious songs from the days of James Cleveland and even going back to the hymns of the church were songs that were full of the gospel message and the story. Where if you never read the Bible, you can learn about God and the gospel just through the songs, amen, that you heard at the church. Come on, somebody. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath the flow, lose all their guilty stain. And so you go on and talk to that. Well, in this generation, if you listen to most of the Christian music or religious music, in some settings, it doesn't even sound different from what is being played on the R&B scene. It doesn't even sound different from what is being played in the secular circles. And there's a bump, there's a rhythm, and they may talk about praising God or worshiping God, but some kind of way, the message of sacrifice, the message of I surrender all, the message of holiness and righteousness, the message of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ finds itself missing from the songs and the music of this culture. And with having parents that are so busy in this complexity of our culture with their jobs, with their schools, fools with mundane activity, amen, chasing the almighty dollar, working two jobs, working time and a half, amen, and then having extracurricular stuff that consumes their time. Parents have not found the time to sit down with their children, amen, and read to them the word of God and give them Bible stories. My first experience, Jasmine, was when my mom gave me my children's Bible, and the children's Bible had pictures in it, and that was the start of me standing right here. My mom gave me, she went and invested, it was $200 or $300. The salesperson came around and he was selling a whole volume of Bible, amen, books, and my mom, David, bought that set, and I was fascinated with those pictures of looking at Noah standing by the ark or David slaying Goliath. I was fascinated, and it made me start reading, which was my pathway to reading the Bible. It was my pathway to learning the things of God. Well, we have a generation that does not have those, amen, mechanisms, those materials put in front of them, because constantly in front of them is a video game. Constantly in front of them is a social media network, be it Facebook or Periscope or Snapchat or YouTube or whatever the platform they choose to use. That's constantly, it controls them, it consumes them. And if it's not that, it is the almighty television. It is almighty television. And believe me, every generation was impacted by the media that ruled their day, whether it was the radio or the television. But we have never seen it so dominated by technology and media, where now we have a whole generation of people who are living their lives vicariously through a video game. Living their life, I mean, they're a Candy Crusher. Or whatever the game is. Or they live their lives through the stuff that's on TV. The housewives or the ghetto girls. Or I can ask y'all some of the, you know, the whatever the ghetto story is. Wherever they sleeping around, wherever they shacking up, wherever they, amen, you know, same sexing and whatever the, and you know what? You don't have to act. You don't have to act. There's no acting. They don't have to have no skill. All you got to do is have drama. Just have some drama, and certainly every generation has drama, but it's unique to the millennials, where there is no shame about their drama. You know, other generations, we had the same drama, but you try to keep it on the down. Don't tell it, don't. Dude, no. They are as ghetto as they could be, and when they max out their ghetto, they want to post it. Am I making this stuff up? Used to be a time where going to the prom, you wanted to be as royal and regal as you could. Come on, ladies. You want to look like you was getting married that night. Well, now, today, they want to look like they're a stripper. I want to show everything I can show. Are you kidding me? Last week, I was in Miami. I was doing some ministry in West Palm, went down to Miami, was going down South Beach, and it was spring break. Only thing I can say is, I'm glad I'm saved. Because if I wasn't saved, I could be 30 people's baby's fathers right now. I could be baby's daddies right now. Especially when you're walking around, they didn't even have on a thong. They had on the next thing. What is it? A string. A T-string. I'm talking about outside, just naked. Just naked. I'm saying, my Lord, my Lord. That's what I'm saying. My Lord, my Lord. Millennial, my Lord, my Lord. Millennial characteristics vary by region depending on their social and economic conditions. However, the generation is generally marked by an increased use and familiarity with communications, media, and digital technologies. Many millennials were born into a global community where exposure to every and anything happens instantly, and the ideal of a process to produce is foreign. The ideal of a process to produce produce is foreign to many millennials. And again, I'm not throwing stones. I'm trying to help all of us understand them and even to help them understand themselves. We come from a time, for instance, my grandfather worked for 35 years in the steel mill. He worked and in his day, he bought a nice house. And my grandmom and my granddad, they drove Cadillacs. But I understood that this was possible. They had moved on up to the east side back in the day where Garfield was somewhere. You live in Garfield? Come on, slow people, keep up. The men don't say Garfield. No, they had time where Garfield, you had moved on up to the east side and they had a Cadillac. They had two Cadillacs in the driveway and every 3 or 4 years they got two new Cadillacs. But I understood that because my grandfather was going to work at 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. And at the same time, my grandma went to work and worked the same job for 30, 40 years and retired. He retired. I understood that the good life came from hard work. Where millennials live in a time where all you got to do is go viral. Millennials live in a time where you can take off all your clothes and take pictures of yourself, and if you get enough hits on your site, people will pay to come to your site and see you naked. So you don't have to be educated. You don't have to go to school. You don't have to work hard. You don't have to plan. You don't have to strategize to actually make it. As a matter of fact, we're dealing with a generation, I hate to say this, that really don't buy into school. They don't buy into education. How hard is it to try to get them and inspire them and teach them that education creates opportunity? Because they don't believe it. They believe you can go to this little school and learn this and go to this little school and learn that and go to this little school, not understanding that when you are part of a university, when you have a real college experience, it's not just the class that you go to, but you're learning how to be a vital part of our society, how to contribute, how to embrace people that are not like yourself, how to expand your concept, how to enhance your communication skills, how to become more a person of the world, where you don't just go and learn this isolated trade, because many of us understand that the world that we live in will present to you the opportunity to work in this field, and that field may dry up. And you may need another set of training or a broader degree that opens up. Hey, I was recently, again, down in Florida. I was talking to, people that I'm in relationship with. And a young lady said, well, I've been working for Cleveland Clinic for years. And because of my education, I was able to leave Cleveland and get a job here. And then I'm leaving Cleveland Clinic because I have another offer with this. And they're giving me 5 offers. I said, well, you got your degree. Yeah, I got my degree. I have a special, and therefore opportunity. She said, I can go to Denver, I can go to California, I can go to Los Angeles, I can go anywhere, and there's opportunity for me because of my education. And sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes our millennials, they don't understand that there is a process that produces success. There's a process that produces, when you see people having a nice house or car or materialistic things, there is a process that's got your mama or your daddy in a place where they can do this, that, and the other for you. And sometimes our millennials, they think they don't need all that process. Well, can you pay for this $30 bill that we just ran up at the restaurant? Nope. Well how could you not have $30, but you know how the world works? Are you understanding what I'm saying? And sometimes it's because they have not, they don't understand, I'm going to deviate from my message here as the Holy Spirit leads me. They don't understand how to make money. Let me give you a scenario. This is how you make money. You don't make money at the event. You make money before the event. Okay, you're going to have a hair show, and you're going to have a hair show. You got people to do hair, and this hair show is going to generate you, $13,000. Well, that's because you don't understand how to make money. If you understand how to make money, the hair show will generate you $150,000. Why? Because you'll start 8 months before the actual show. And then you'll do all of your, amen, reconnaissance. You'll find out what's the best venue. You'll find out what's the best region. And then you will go to, amen, five different other hair shows around the country and see what works and see what doesn't work. And then you'll sit down and get some counsel from people who have done hair shows before. And then you will bring in other guests, celebrity guests, music gifts. And then you will make an investment of $2,500 in radio time and TV time and advertisement. You get on every social media platform, and for 8 months you will saturate this thing. And next thing you know it, amen, by the time your day gets here, you don't have 75 people. You got 640 people that have attended your venue. They have bought your products. They have, and you made $150,000. Well, not that night. Over 8 months, you made money. And there is this element sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes there's this element in our millennials that think you make money on the night of the event. That's not how you make money. You make money in the reconnaissance. You make money in the work, in the preparation work. And that goes with everything. It's not just your hair show. It's your business. It's your dream. It's your ideal. It doesn't happen in a day. It happens by all the books that you're reading, all the mentors and the tutelage that you're getting. And the day comes where you have millions of dollars, but you don't make it in the day that you make it. You make it over a process. There is a process that produces, and sometimes our millennials have been robbed of this knowledge. Therefore, they go through life with this sense of instant gratification. They want it right now. They want a good marriage right now. They want a good relationship right now. Are you hearing what I'm saying? This is the age of complexity. Number one, one of the challenges of this age, and when I say this age, I'm not just talking about our millennials. I'm talking about everybody that's alive at this time. At this time, one of our challenges, the complexities of our society, is that we don't buy any longer into systems, but systems work. People want to, they want to go out of the system. They want to veer from the system. And I think that change can be good, but there are some components of systems that work. One of the components of systems that work is consistency. That is a component of a system. If you go to a plant and there's an assembly line, the gentleman or the lady, she is doing the same thing every day, and it's consistent. And it's consistent. Every day you do the same thing. And part of our culture is we like to break from systems. Systems. We say things like, "You ain't got to do all that. It don't take all that. You can't do all that." And yet, okay, just come up with another way. But you better have a system that you are committed to doing the same thing. All the time, Corey, when there's a new system that comes out, and you can say, "Well, you don't have to. Hey, you don't have to buy a house that way. You don't have to buy a car that way." That's fine, but you got to find the right system, and you got to stay with the system. You got to commit to the system. And sometimes we, not just our millennials, but all of us, are challenged because we don't want to commit to the system of saving, of investing, of working out, getting your workout in. You can't just do it like me. 2 days and think everything is going to be wonderful. Bishop Clark, submit to the system. You know it's exercise and diet. But some kind of way in my mind, in our minds, some of y'all done tried pills and I hadn't got to the pills yet. And take this pill and you will disappear. Wabow! Nah, there's a real system. Another thing that our culture is challenged with is that we are not given to relationships. This is very key. That because of technology and the, I'm telling you, the strength of media and entertainment, we have the foundation of our relationships are virtual. They are virtual. What do you mean? In social media, you have friends online that you don't have relationship with. Especially our millennials, they'll play video games with people they've never seen, never, nothing. and they have interaction, and yet the whole ideal of real relationship is not, it's not a part of their, it's not a part of their world. And sometimes even we who are not a part of this generation buy into these ideals, and yet you know better. You know that because somebody say your friend, they're your friend. Come on, Mike, that don't mean nothing. People like you because you're cute today, because they have an ulterior motive. People like you when you got money. People like you because you can contribute to their program or whatnot. And yet a real friend is there when they have nothing to give you or you have nothing to give them. This is friendship. It's real interaction. It's seeing them. It's being able to correct them. It's being able to call them and say, hey, I didn't like what you said. You offended me. And y'all begin to go back and forth. And after the smoke clears, you're still here. Come on, Joe. You're still here. You can take a licking and keep on ticking. You can make it. But sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes among our millennials, when there is a challenge or a conflict in a relationship, that's it. And even if it's their mama, their sister, their brother, or their bishop, or their pastor, they have a little, just a little turbulence, and I'm out of here. Peace out. Those that have gotten married that are under the age of 35, divorce rate is about 70%. 70%. You know why? Because I'm out. I got 600 friends on Facebook. You don't sit here and talk to me that way? I'm out of here. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The mundane, number three, the mundane demands our greatest commitment. In this culture, again, not just millennials, the entire culture has shifted to, we're living in a time where that which is not important demands our greatest commitment. A video game, scandal, power, empire, I don't know what else they are, housewives, Price is Right. I don't know what's hot because I'm not into that. But I'm preaching to an entire church that got their shows. It's not a sin, but you got your show. You know you got your show. Whatever your show is, I can say, what's your show? You can tell me what your show is. You know what your show is. That's your show. And you know what? It's amazing that your emotions are tied to. Oh, man, you having a good show. You having a good day. When your character on the show gets messed up, you mad at everybody. I mean, you think you're a part of the show. And you don't even understand, sometimes they're actors, and even in the reality, they just acting. You know, the reality shows are about ratings. If you don't get ratings, so they say, okay, Candy, we're going to have a fight next week, all right? Now, you act the fool, just don't mess up my hair. Don't mess up my hair, all right? The mundane demands our greatest commitment, whether it's our TV shows, whether it's our video games. Hey, even if it's our side activities, nowadays, if you join anything, join yoga, join soccer, if your kid play baseball, basketball, if it's anything, and that used to be a time where that's just a part of your life. Now, if they join, it dominates your life. Yeah, your kids, they're on a traveling team. Now they got to go to Florida. Come on, Jasmine. Now you got to go to New York, and they're going over here. Man, wait a minute. What happened to the time where the family life was the most important thing? Sitting around the table and talking and getting your homework done and knowing your teachers and going outside to play some ball and knowing your friend next door. That's no longer important. What's important is you're on the team, and you got to do this and you got to do that, and it consumes your life. And this is the mundane. This is the trivial. This is the second tier level of important things in your life, and yet it demands your greatest commitment. We're challenged. We're challenged because, hey man, the blended family has become the norm. We're challenged because gender distinction, hey man, in our culture, not just among millennials, in our entire culture is not important. Gender distinction. So the boys could dress like girls, look like girls, the girls could dress like boys, act like boys, and nobody's affected by it. It's not important in our culture. In our culture, there is what we call alternative truth. Is anybody familiar with this concept? alternative truth. I don't have time because I'm not throwing stones or making anything, but we just have alternative truth today, all the way to the highest level in the land, all the way to the office of the presidency of the United States of America. We have an alternative truth where the facts fall subject to the feelings. So what you feel is more true than the facts. You can have the real facts right here. And they say, nah, I don't believe that. I believe the way I feel. So the way you feel is true because that's the way you feel instead of the facts. And this spirit has literally permeated our society. Alternative truth. You have people are developing their own moral compass. There is no sense of right and wrong that finds its origin in the Word of God. Church, God, and the Bible are optional in our culture. Not just to our millennials, in our culture. These things are optional in the minds of many people that are alive today. And other religions and their faith are just as relevant as the Holy Word of God. In our culture. In our culture. Forget that the Bible says that when they put the Ark of the Covenant in the temple of Dagon amongst the Philistines, that this Dagon, this Triton, fell on his face. And they set it back up. And they went to the temple the next day. And the Bible said not only had it fallen down, but the head was cut off and the hands were cut off. Why? Because God was saying there's only one true God. There's only one real God. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. But the spirit that permeates our culture is, you got to be respectful towards other folks' religion and this, that. No, I'm not saying that you should disrespect them, but their religion and their faith, I do not elevate to the platform of the unadulterated Word of God. The Bible said heaven and earth will pass away, but the Word of God will stand forever. Now, you learn how to honor people, but I'm sorry, except you believe in Jesus Christ, he's the only access to the Father. But in our culture, we elevate everybody's religion to the level of your religion, to the level of your faith. I'm not saying you disrespect people. You got some people that believe that they should kill people. How about ISIS? They believe that if you're not a part of their culture and their faith, you're an infidel and you should be killed. So should we elevate their faith to this? It's just, that's their faith, just like our faith. No. The Word of God, the Bible says, let God be true and every man a liar. And you can almost sense even in this setting, there's almost a pause like, wait a minute, be careful, Bishop. You don't want to offend nobody. You can feel that rose right in the room. And yet the Word of God came to bring a sword. The Word of God came to divide. The Word of God comes to bring judgment. The Word of God does that. I want to talk about, amen, specifically our millennials. I'm on third base now. The pros and cons of this millennial generation. Number one, there's some great things about this millennial. There's some great things about your culture, about your generation. Awesome. Incredible. I honor it. I appreciate it. Number one thing that I think is incredible about our millennials is their creativity. Man, this is the most creative generation. I've never seen it. The world has never seen it. Uber. Who thinks of this stuff? Millennials. Where they turn everybody. I was on the plane the other day. I said, well, we need to get an Uber for planes. Somebody else came up with an Uber for women. They say some women, they don't like to be picked up by men and they're a little afraid. And so somebody in your generation said, well, let's just create another stream of revenue just for women. So when women call Uber, they only get women to come and pick them up and take them where they need to go. That's the creativity. Hey, Snapchat. Snap it, talk about it. I mean, forget about it. I mean, my God, that's the creativity of this generation. This generation is not judgmental. That is a virtue. Because we came up in a culture, in a society that judged people. We were taught to judge people based on the way they looked. You saw a person had dreadlocks, you formed an opinion about them. You saw a person, hey man, that was one race married to another race, you formed an opinion about them. You saw a person dressed a certain way, you formed an opinion about them. This culture, this generation, they don't care what you look like. They don't care who you marry. They don't care. They don't care. They really sit in a seat where they're just not judgmental. Somebody smoke, somebody drink, that's who you are. That's you. Well, we came up in a time where you looked at people funny. Am I right? You know it's the truth. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They're not judgmental, and that's a good thing. Number three, the pros of this millennial culture, this generation, they are open to new people and new experiences. They go bungee jumping, they go parasailing, they do all of this, whatever, exploring. Number four, they're better at adapting to change than any generation before them. The millennials, y'all, if it changed, let's go with the new thing. All right, if it changed again, let's go with the new thing. If it changed again, let's go with the new thing. How many of them started out on Facebook? Then they went to something else. Now they into this. Now I ain't on that no more. And the girl, you ain't with this no? They just keep it moving. In our culture, we don't like all that change. Come on, Mary and Payne. We don't like all that change. Soon as we learn one thing, they done gone to something else. iPhone 7. I don't need no iPhone 7. I was mad with my iPhone 3 here. Still got my flip phone here. We don't like all that change, but in this culture, things keep on changing. Now let's take a look at, amen, briefly some of the cons, some of the challenges that the millennials have. One of the challenges, and again, when I say these statements, they're not blanket statements. They're not blanket statements. It's not everybody, Dave. It's just some of them in the millennial culture. They don't have an appreciation for history. Like I'm excited about going to D.C. to see the new historical museum. I'm excited about that. Sometimes if you talk to the millennials, But I wanted to see, I went and saw the Dr. Martin Luther King Monument. What's that about? You know, sometimes millennials, and then when you have movies that come out, 12 Years a Slave, right? Why am I watch that? Hey, they flicking through the station. I'm a star. Roots. Oh, really? Really? Am I right? Am I right? You don't want to see that stuff. And this is what they say. Oh, that's why we still have a lot of racism and hatred, because y'all keep feeding yourself this stuff and looking at this stuff. We don't want to see that crap. Yet, if you don't have a sense of history, you're doomed to repeat it. If you don't know where you come from, you don't have a sense of where you're going. A lot of our millennials cannot appreciate the magnitude, and not just our millennials, because some people are affected by the same spirit that our millennials have been affected by, and that is they cannot even appreciate the magnitude of having an African American president. You know how big that is? And then some of them would say, why do we got to have Black Lives Matter? Well, when shooting young black men becomes a sport, I just recently learned young man was stopped in his car. He didn't know why he was stopped, got out, started running. They shot him with a taser. And he kept on struggling. They shot him again with a taser. And after I heard the story, I said, thank you, Jesus. That's the posture that I had. I said, thank you, Jesus. Why did I say that? where some of our millennials wouldn't understand why I would say, thank you, Jesus. They would be mad saying, why is that your attitude? My attitude is that because there is a culture of shooting black people dead. They kill them. So I'm glad the young man didn't get killed. So I say, thank you, Jesus. Was it wrong for him to run? Sure, he's wrong. He shouldn't run. Why you run? But if you don't understand history, if you don't understand African Americans being slaves in America, if you don't understand Emancipation Proclamation, to a lot of people meant nothing. When slaves were set free, that meant nothing. So a black man who looks at a white woman, who looks at her, come on, Emmett Till, come on, Emmett Till. Our millennials will say, who is Emmett Till? He's a man that looked at a black woman or looked at a white woman. And they beat him to death. They killed him. And if you didn't get beat to death or lynched, you got put in jail. And so if you look in the penal institution and you see that 80% of our jails are filled with African Americans, blacks, you say, well, why is that? When we're only 13% of the population as African Americans and only 8% of the population as men, 8% as men in America are black men. And 80% of those incarcerated are black men. So how do you have this disparity? How do you have this inequity? Because in some people's minds, we're still in a time of slavery. There's no equality. A young black man gets caught with a little weed, some drugs on him. 30 years in jail. 30 years. We know of a scenario where a young man got life in jail. Life in jail for pushing weed. Life without the possibility of parole. Life, a 40-year sentence? Life. Whereas some of our counterpartners, Caucasians, same amount, you don't even go to jail. Am I making this stuff up, y'all? I'm not making this stuff up. Where even sometimes in our universities, the African American has got to be three times better to get the same grade. Where we don't even encourage our kids to go to school. Where they got to be three times better to get the same job. I just want to go off the record saying this. If Michelle Obama had run for the president of the United States, she would be the president. Because she is one of the most educated, articulate, gifted, charismatic women we have ever seen. 10 times better. She 10 times, no slight against Hillary, wonderful. But Miss Obama? 10 times better. And yet you have to be 10 times better to get the same grade. But if you don't understand the history of our country, if you don't understand that, then you don't have an appreciation for that. One of the challenges, they don't value history. Another challenge is they don't submit to authority. I just referenced how the police says, put your hands up. Why I gotta put my hands up, man? Please, put your hands up. Why do I gotta put my hands up? I ain't do nothing. Listen, right now, the issue is not what you did. The issue is what you gonna do. And sometimes they haven't been taught authority. I am glad at this stage in my life, I'm 50 years old, but I'm glad that my mom popped me in my mouth when I said something. Mama, bow! And I was too afraid to say something to my dad. Because if my mom was popping me in my mouth, are you kidding me? I learned authority. And I'm not suggesting that you abuse your children by any means. But I learned authority at the house. Get up and take your garbage out. Okay, I'll do it in a minute. Go get me the belt. Forget the garbage. Go get the belt. Why? Because when I tell you to do something, you're going to do it. So now if the police pulls me over, oh, dude, I'm not saying I'll do that in a minute. I understand what happens when you don't obey authority. You learn that at home. And this goes out to the baby boomers, to many of us. Hey, man, it is very important that you teach your children authority so they don't get shot down, beat up, or put in jail and learn authority by force. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Lord, have mercy. I need a little bit more time this morning, but maybe I'll cut it and I'll pick it up again next week. Number three, the cons of our millennial generation. Many times they connect virtually through technology and media and don't really experience the truth of physical, personal, social interaction. Business is done through computers and things of that nature, text. And text does not communicate emotion. There's an emotion in the voice and words and stuff and emojis and that stuff is cute. But if you really want to understand a person, you got to talk to them. You got to interact with them. You got to be in their presence before you are committed. They're making sexual commitment and sexual decisions virtually. They're making life decisions, choices where they have not, they don't have real interaction where you can call, where there's a challenge, you can call. I'm right here. Let's talk. Let's meet. Let's figure it out. Let's talk through it. Let's understand. If there's been offense, let me apologize. If there's correction needed, let me give you the instruction. Because there's real interaction here. And yet, many times amongst our millennials, their society is so structured that it's moved us away from interaction with people. Let me say to our millennials, your mother, your father are the most important person in your life. If you got kids, there it is. You don't want to elevate somebody else's counsel above them. You want to talk to your girls. Or you want to talk to your fellas, or you want to see what other folk. Listen, they don't love you. They don't care about you. They don't pay for you. They're not committed to you on that level. All right. And finally, I guess I'll turn and wrap it up here, bring closure. The last challenge with our millennials is sometimes they're spiritually disengaged. There's a verse in Matthew 11. It says, verse 16, it says, whereunto shall I liken this generation? Like children sitting in the marketplace, calling to their fellows, saying, we have piped unto you, and you have not danced. We've mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented. He says, John the Baptist came eating and drinking, and you said, he have a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and you said, he's a gluttonous wine bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. And then he began to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done because they repented not. What Jesus said, he said, what shall I liken this generation to? He says, they're like people in a marketplace and music is being played, but they won't dance. Or they go to a funeral and everybody's crying, but they won't cry. It's like you can't. They don't engage with the Spirit. The Spirit of God is dictating one thing, and they're not responsive to that. The Spirit of God is dictating another thing, and they're not responsive to that. And then Christ gives this analogy. He said, when John the Baptist was eating and drinking, you said, let me give the exact words. When John the Baptist came eating and drinking, you said he's a gluttonous man and a wine bibber. Or excuse me, verse 18, it says, he had the devil. John the Baptist, he have a devil. And then Jesus said, well, I came eating and drinking, and you said, oh, he's gluttonous. He's a wine bibber. He's a friend of sinners. On one extreme, he says, John the Baptist sanctified himself and presented himself as a holy, righteous man. You said, he had a devil. So then I hang out with y'all, sit and be your friend, and you say, oh, he's a sinner too. It's like you try this approach, don't work. You try that approach, don't work. Some of you parents can identify with me where you try to love them and do good and bless them, and sometimes that don't work. And then you try to be mean. Hey, good cop, bad cop. Then you go bad cop on them, and that don't work. And you sit there and say, I can't figure this generation out. One of the challenges of this generation is that they don't engage spiritually. They don't engage. And I'll conclude with this. When we look at the Word of God, our faith is handed down from generation to generation. Our original text says that one generation shall praise the Lord's name or his works to the next generation. One of the problems that's happening, one of the challenges with our millennials is we, the older generation, we're not really passing our faith to them in the way the scripture says we should. Notice, Vanetta, in the Bible, the Lord was the God of your fathers. So when the Lord spoke to Moses, he said, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham passed his faith to Isaac. Isaac passes his faith to Jacob. And so Abraham has a long history of the God of his fathers. And some kind of way, this millennial generation has been robbed of the knowledge of the God of their fathers. One of the reasons that I do not have a problem serving God is because my mother told me we were so broke. We were so poor. We didn't have enough food. I remember she told me that she would set Donnell, all three of us down to let us eat. And whatever we didn't eat was what she ate. We had days like that. I had days where I watched my mom walk to the bus stop to catch a bus, amen, to work and work washing clothes and leave that job and catch another bus to another job. And every Christmas we had new tennis shoes and a Hot Wheel track and everything else. I watched that and I listened to my mom pray and say, Lord, make a way. Lord, help us. Lord, and I watched my mom in church give $100, give $1,000, give $500 to the work of the Lord. And yet I saw God raise my family up. Well, we got a house. Well, we got cars. Well, we got things. And we were blessed. And we had what we needed. All three of my two siblings, my brother, we were blessed. I watched that. And my mom would always say, I trust God. The Lord made a way. I didn't know what was going to happen, and the Lord did, and the Lord did. My faith was passed down. My faith was passed down. I remember going over to my grandmother's house, and my grandmother would tell us stories and testimonies of how the Lord made a way and how the Lord protected. I remember driving in the car, and almost, matter of fact, I got a scar right now over one of my eyes, I don't know, it's a scar. And my mom said, when you was a child, we were in a car accident and your head went up and hit the glass and you almost went through the glass and I got the scar. And she said, I called on the name of Jesus and the Lord protected us and preserved us. I have that testimony. So when challenges come, I have a faith that was passed down where one generation praised the Lord to the next generation. You cannot tell me that, amen to God, Isaac in his faith. The Bible says about Isaac that Isaac sold in the time of famine. Where did he get this faith to do this in Genesis 26? Because his father told him, amen, about 10 chapters ago, I had a knife over you, but the Lord put a ram in the bushes. The Lord calls, my God, a way out of no way. The Lord provided, come on, Pastor. The Lord provided, amen, in times of trouble, in times of lack, God opened doors for me. And that faith was passed down from Abraham to Isaac. You cannot tell me, amen, that Solomon was not impacted by the life of his father, David. We understand that Solomon was the wisest man in all the earth. We understand that Solomon, amen, wrote over 3,000 Proverbs. We understand that Solomon, amen, was wealthy and powerful and influential, and he builds the house of God. But you cannot tell me that Isaac was not impacted by the faith of his father, David. You cannot tell me that there weren't times that David, amen, told his son there was a giant named Goliath that stood in front of me, and I didn't come with sticks and stones, but I fought that giant in the name of the Lord. Let me tell you today, parents ought to begin to tell you, you need to tell your children how you got to where you are, how you got the man that you have. You need to tell your children how you prayed and asked God to lead you and order your steps. You need to tell your
children. How, amen, when you made the worst mistakes of your life and you thought your life was over, amen, to God, some kind of way, the Lord restored your self-esteem and the Lord forgave you and washed you and cleansed you. You need to tell your children how that your marriage was in dire straits, and by the grace of God, amen, he kept you together. You need to tell your children how when you lost your job and you didn't have ends meet, my God, you couldn't make your ends meet. You couldn't, amen, bring your money together. Your output was greater than your intake, and your upkeep was becoming your downfall. You need to tell them that the Lord himself opened up the doors and provided for you and kept food on your table and kept you in your right mind. Amen to God. You need to tell your children how that when you were sick and could not get well, when the medicine wouldn't work and the therapy was not working and there was a bad report from the doctor, you need to tell them that you called on the Lord and he began to answer, amen, your prayer. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 5, he says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and am now persuaded that in thee also. In other words, the apostle Paul said to his son in the gospel, Timothy, he said, when you begin to teach the faith, amen, tell him it's the same faith that was in your grandmother. Tell him it's the same faith that was in your mother. In other words, one generation began to praise the works of the Lord to the next generation. And I believe that in the 21st century, one of the things that the modern church has got to do is focus on a dying generation. Millennial generation is the greatest generation that's alive on the planet today. The millennial generation is, amen, a generation that has outnumbered every generation before it. And yet, my God, it's the smallest demographic in the church. And if this demographic is growing and this demographic in the church is shrinking, then what's happening with the church? Let me tell you, the church is in danger of losing an entire generation. I thank God for tongue talking and rolling in the floor, but what are we doing with this generation? I thank God for laying hands on the sick and prophesying and moving, my God, in the supernatural, but what are we doing with this generation? Well, the world is after this generation. The Bible says that the thief comes but for to kill, steal, and destroy. Yeah. And the spirit of homosexuality and same-sex marriage is running rapid. The spirit of suicide is taking over in this generation. The spirit of drug addiction and drug abuse and pornography is taking over this generation. Many of our children are addicted to video games and addicted to cell phones and media sites and social media outlets. And my God, you're spending 12 and 13 hours in front of the TV every single day. Yeah. Am I right about it? Yeah, there's some great things in the generation, but the devil is using them, amen to God, many times trying to distort their minds and pervert them towards the things of God. They're not thinking about coming to church or listening to the word of the Lord. And yet the Bible says that heaven and earth will pass away, but the word will stand forever. The only thing that's strong in this life, the only thing that you can really build your life on, the only thing that you can really trust in is the name of the Lord. And we've got to praise his name to the next generation. We've got to pass our faith on to the next generation. We've got to teach them how to pray. I know you are a praying man and understand the power of prayer, but what about the next generation? Come on, Vanessa. You know how to stand between the porch and the altar. You know how to intercede until things are birthed into the spirit. But what about the next generation? There are those that know how to sow seeds of faith and support the work of God with tithes and offerings. But what about the next generation? Do we know what the colleges are pumping into our children? Do we know what the media platforms are pumping into our children? Come on, faith. We come from a long legacy of spiritual spirituality. But what about the next generation? Are we going to watch them walk away from the church and walk away from God and walk away from the word of God and only want to call out to God when their back is up against the wall? Because the same trouble that came in your life is going to find its way in their life. And you called on the name of the Lord and God heard you and delivered you from your place of weakness and pain. What will they do if they're looking at jail time? What are they going to do if they find themselves strung out on drugs? What are they going to do if they find themselves addicted to pornography? What will they do if they're in, my God, the complexity of gender identity? What are they going to do if they can't find a job? What are they going to do if they got to raise their children all by themselves? What are they going to do when they don't have their car note, they don't have their light note, they don't have their rent, they don't have the bills? What are they going to do when there's no money to go and get an education? They've got to call on the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run in it, and they are saved. They need to know that he is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Now, if he did it for Moses, and he did it for your mama, he will do it for you. So say, yeah. Now, I want you to know that the posture of the body of Christ assembly is that we are winning a generation. Now, we're not kicking you all to the curb. You're not a second thought in our imagination. You're not going to be placed on the back burner. But I'm believing for some millennials to accept the call to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm believing for some millennials to preach, pray, and prophesy. I'm believing for some millennials to go to school and be great. I'm believing for millennials to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. I'm believing for millennials to have influence in the political arena. Now, I'm believing for millennials to have influence in the performing arts. I'm believing for millennials to have the power of the spoken word. I'm believing in millennials that have dreams and visions of the plan of God. I believe that we're raising up a generation that's going to praise God. They're going to learn the power of prayer. They're going to learn to speak the power of the word of God. They're going to stand on their faith. They're going to learn how to wait on God. They'll say, I'm young, I'm gifted, and I'm sanctified. I'm full of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. So see, he is the God of my fathers. He did it for your daddy. He did it for your mama. He can do it for you. So see, so see, yeah. I believe, God, that this generation, they're not going to be high on drugs. They're not a reefer smoking generation. They're not a dropout generation. They're not a lazy generation. They're not a no good generation. They're not an ignorant generation. They're not a generation pregnant out of wedlock. They're not an abortion generation. But this is a prophetic generation. This is a blessed generation. This is an anointed generation. So saying, so saying. My Bible says, there shall be a people created that shall praise the Lord. God's got some young folk that know how to give their lunch, and Jesus will multiply the lunch. Folk that know how to lead Samson to the pillars in the Philistine temple. God's got some children out of the mouths of babes and sucklings. Thou perfected praise, thou ordained strength. God's got some children, and they're crying, Hosanna! 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 See now, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. My Bible says, your young men shall have dreams, and your old men shall have vision. This for your sons and daughters. They shall prophesy. They'll speak with new tongues. They'll eat and drink any deadly thing, and it will not harm them. The gospel of Jesus Christ is relevant to your generation. The same way I'm healed, you can be healed. The same power I have, you can have. According to your faith, so be it unto you. He's not just a God of people who are in their 40s. He's not just a God of those who are in their 50s, 60s, or 70s. You don't just need God in your dying day, but this is the day. This is the day the Lord has made. Somebody say, "Amen." I shall rejoice and be glad in it. He's a right now God. Let me preach to the millennials. If you call on Jesus, he will answer prayer. Let me preach to my millennials. He's a way maker. He's a bridge over troubled water. He's a way out of no way. He's bread when you're hungry. He's food on your table. He'll be clothes on your back. He will be your battle axe. He will be your protector. He will give you angels that will watch over you. He will give you favor. He will order your steps. He will give you favor. He will open up doors before you. He will heal your body. He will save your marriage. He will put you in a business. He will make you healthy, wealthy, and wise. He will prosper you. He will raise you up. He will give you a great name. He will make you somebody. He will take you from the bottom and put you on the top. He will change your identity. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And if you will trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't lean to your own understanding, in all of your ways acknowledge him, he will direct your path. He will heal your body. He will make you the head and not the tail. Let's rise it up and sitting down, going out and coming in. Let me hear your war cry. Wake up, church. Wake up, church. I would to God that the Holy Ghost would fall. Thank you, Jesus. I need the Holy Ghost to fall. Fall on our young people. Fall on our teenagers. Baptize them in the Holy Ghost. Change them. Fill them with the power of God. I want all of my millennials, stand on your feet. Come on, millennials. If you're 13 to 35, stand on your feet. I challenge you right now. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary. Open up your mouth and bless the God of your fathers. Bless the God of Abraham. Bless the God of Isaac. Bless the God of Jacob. God is good. God is great. He's the everlasting Father. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the Lion of Judah. He's the Good Shepherd. He's the Great I Am. He's the Son of God. He's the Elohim. He's the Yahweh. He's the Shaddai. He's the Nisi. He's the Lord your banner. He's the Rapha. He's God that healeth thee. Somebody, bless the Lord with all your soul. Let everything that have breath, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Get running in your feet. Get clapping in your hands. Leap for joy. Shabbat. Barak. Tahila. Zamar. Yay! Bless him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Holy Ghost, fall on him. Baptize him. Use him. Anoint him. So say yeah. So say yeah. So say yeah. So say yeah. Go ahead and praise the Lord, somebody. Go ahead and praise the Lord, somebody. Go ahead and praise the Lord. Hey!
It's our time now. Whose time is it?
B-O-C-A.
Well, praise the Lord. Once again, I'm Bishop Eric Kincaid Clark, and I certainly pray that this message has blessed you, strengthened you, and encouraged you in your walk with God. I would like for you to sow a seed, a tithe, or a special offering into the work of God as we here at the Body of Christ Assembly are a church in the city impacting the world. We're doing the work of God, and we do desire you to partner with us as we go forth and accomplish our Father's work. Until next time, peace to the family.
So just open up your heart.